Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, that we may continually be given to good works. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Our epistle lesson comes from the book of Hebrews, Chapter 4, verses 12 through 16. Let us hear the word of the Lord. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. May God add his blessing to this holy reading. Please join me in the reading of Psalm 37. Do not be angry because of the wicked. Do not be envious of the wrongdoers. Trust in the Lord and do good, so you will dwell in the land and enjoy security.
Take delight in the Lord, who will give you the desires of your heart.
Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in God, who will act, bringing forth your vindication as the light and your right as the noonday. Refrain from anger and forsake wrath. Do not be angry. It leads only to evil.
For the wicked shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall possess the land.
Yet a little while, and the wicked will be no more. Though you look at their place, they will not be there.
But the meek shall possess the land and delight.
Amen.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. I missed all of you last week, but I heard Bob did an excellent job, as well as everyone else who helps out each week, putting on our services. You may remember last week's text was a hard teaching regarding divorce, remarriage, sticky issues. And here we are again, Jesus making us uncomfortable. This gospel lesson is well known to many of us. A rich young man comes to Jesus, falls at his feet, and says, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Notice that this guy probably inherited everything he has. So it's strange that he would ask what he can do to inherit eternal life. No one decides what he or she inherits. You don't work for an inheritance. You're just born into it. And he should know that better than anyone. But then we see Jesus, snarky as ever, isn't buying this guy's flattery. He says, "Why do you call me good? There is no one good but God." And then he says, "You know the commandments," and he lists them. "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, you shall not defraud, honor your father and mother." And the man replies, "I've kept these commandments my whole life." Likely story, right? Jesus responds, "But you lack one thing. Go and sell your possessions and give the money to the poor, and then come and follow me." And St. Mark tells us the man was grieved by this. He was grieving as though he had lost a loved one because he was so rich. He was so rich that his money and possessions were like family to him. Who knows the Ten Commandments by heart? I'm not going to quiz you. Did your Sunday school teacher drill these into your head like mine did? So you probably know that they appear in two places, Exodus and Deuteronomy. And you probably notice that Jesus' list here is peculiar. Really, he only names five of the Ten Commandments, and one that isn't found in either Exodus or Deuteronomy. But Jesus, like most Jewish folks at the time, knew the Torah inside and out, so it's worth noticing what he includes and what he leaves out. The list of commandments Jesus gives is what's called the second table, all those commandments that concern our relations with people rather than with God, perhaps implying that how we treat other people determines our status in the kingdom of God. Jesus includes a commandment that isn't found there, do not defraud. And this takes the place of do not covet. And I have two thoughts about this. First, this man is rich, so the question of coveting is probably irrelevant to him. He probably has everything he could need. Second, it's very possible that Jesus says do not defraud for a good reason. You don't get to be rich in the midst of poverty like that man without cheating someone. But the man couldn't give it all up. And so Jesus tells his disciples, the rich are beyond saving. How hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. It is impossible. We have to see how radical this is. Traditional Near Eastern religions said that wealth is a sign of God's favor. Much like some Christians today, they believed that if you were rich, you could be confident God was on your side. So Jesus is telling this man that he must give up everything that told him God was on his side if he wants to have real eternal life. But if we take the Bible seriously, we find a new way to understand wealth. While God wants to bring everyone into salvation, over and over again, we're told that God takes the side of the poor. In the law, God promises the people prosperity only if they live with open hands toward the poor. The prophets constantly reminded them of their failure to do so. And Jesus calls his followers to make drastic changes to the way they think about wealth. We aren't reading the Bible honestly if we ignore this fact. We aren't hearing the gospel honestly if we ignore it. As Karl Barth put it, we do not really know Jesus, the Jesus of the New Testament, if we do not know him as this poor man, as this, if we may risk the dangerous word, partisan of the poor, and finally as this revolutionary. So it's important to remember that possessions aren't intrinsically bad. Neither is money. All that we have is a gift from God, but it's what we do with what we have that's good or evil. A gift can be misused if it's meant to be shared and kept to oneself. For God, possessions aren't what matters. God owns everything anyway. It's people that matter to God. And our salvation, something we tend to think about exclusively in terms of inner piety sometimes, is directly tied to what we do with what we have. It is easier for a 7-foot-tall, 10-foot-long camel, the largest animal anyone at that time knew in that place, it is easier for this camel to fit through the eye of a needle than it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. Their salvation is impossible. We all know wealth disparity is real. The top 1% of our country owns 40% of the wealth. Half of the country is poor or near poor, with near poor meaning one missed paycheck from financial ruin. Wealth disparity in our nation today, the gap between the rich and the poor, is wider than at the height of the Roman Empire. And there is no convincing reason why a single person goes without food, shelter, or medical care in the wealthiest nation in the history of the world. But of course, the picture is even bleaker globally. See, I know that relative to the rest of the world, I am pretty wealthy. My wife and I have a house and two cars. I have more books than anyone could ever need. We have food in our pantry. We have clean water that comes out of our tap anytime we turn it on. 500 million children will go hungry worldwide today. And 1 billion people will have no source of clean water. I have somewhat decent access to healthcare. I can go to the doctor anytime I don't feel well, spend a somewhat reasonable amount of money, as long as it isn't too serious, and get better. Plenty of people in the United States, let alone the world, can't say the same. I have spent thousands of dollars on higher education. Granted, most of that was other people's money. But an education itself is something to which many lack basic access. Maybe I'm rich in the grand scheme of things. I have a pretty comfortable life, relatively speaking. Maybe like the rich young man in this gospel story, my salvation is impossible. Getting back to him, it is unlikely, but maybe he really did keep all of those commandments about treating other people the right way his entire life. So what did Jesus leave out? He leaves out the whole first table of the commandments, where God says to the people, "I am the Lord your God. Have no other gods before me. Don't make graven images. Don't take my name in vain. Honor the Sabbath day." Jesus says you lack something after leaving these commandments out. He's trying to help this man see how he worships money and possessions and how true this is of our idolatrous society in which everything is determined by profits and the bottom line. John Wesley, one of the great founders of Methodism, he wrote a lot about the idolatry of money. That when we place our trust in bank accounts, we aren't trusting in God, which helps us see how ironic it is that our money declares, "In God we trust." According to Wesley, loving wealth keeps us from loving God and neighbor. He taught that wealth brings with it a great temptation to atheism. Not that one stops believing in God kind of mentally, but that we kind of in practice become atheists. Because if we are rich, we can easily forget that we are creatures and we are utterly dependent upon God the Creator for our existence. We might become prideful and fall into the delusional belief that we are self-sufficient. So Wesley called wealth a hindrance to holiness. We cannot enter salvation in this life or in the life of the world to come if we are rich. But as he pointed out, one that has food and clothing sufficient for himself and his family and something over is rich. Here Wesley follows the early church, like St. Basil the Great, who in the 4th century said that if you have bread in your cabinet or clothing in your wardrobe and your neighbor is hungry or naked, then you have stolen from your neighbor. Basil's contemporary, St. John Chrysostom, agreed. He preached that failing to share one's resources is robbery. But Wesley didn't always see wealth in this way. When he first started teaching at Oxford, he found himself making a comfortable living, so he was able to spend his money on frivolous things. As he put it, he was spending it on card games, alcohol, and tobacco. But one day, he had just purchased some pictures to decorate his room when he noticed a chambermaid, you know, housekeeping, out in the cold with nothing but the linen gown she was wearing. And his heart went out to her. He wanted to help her. But he reached into his pocket and realized he didn't have enough money left after his new art purchase. He said in this moment, he asked himself, "Will thy master say, 'Well done, good and faithful steward? Thou hast adorned thy walls with the money which might have screened this poor creature from the cold. O justice, O mercy, are not these pictures the blood of this poor maid?'" Not long after this, Wesley began limiting his expenses so that he could share all that he could with the poor. So he made 30 pounds that year, and his expenses came out to 28. So he gave the other two away. The next year, his income doubled to 60 pounds, but he continued living at 28 pounds a year and gave the rest away. And this pattern continued throughout his life. One year he made over 1,400 pounds, but he still lived on 28 and gave away the rest. So there is a conversation, of course, that we should have about where to draw the line. Certainly we should take care of ourselves and our families and plan for the future. And we should enjoy God's gifts. It's okay to spend a little money for fun, I promise. It is okay to work hard and play hard. But at what point are we hoarding wealth or throwing it away on frivolities when God intends for it to be shared with those in need? This is an interesting topic, and we could be here all day to talk about it. So I hope instead you'll join us on Wednesday for our Bible study at 6 p.m., and hopefully we'll talk more about that. But in this story, we at least see Jesus call us away from the worldly temptation to put wealth and possessions at the center of our lives. He calls us to be willing to leave behind everything for his sake and for the sake of the gospel. And finally, there's a crucial detail here that we sometimes forget about this story. St. Mark tells us that Jesus looked at this man and loved him. Jesus knew that this man had more than he needed while his neighbors went without. He knew that wealth was this man's God, but he loved him. So Jesus' invitation to this guy to sell everything and give it all away is a direct call to create justice for the poor. But what is significant is that Jesus tells him to do this not because he wants to condemn the rich, but because he loves this man and wants to bring him into God's kingdom. And so it is with us. Jesus wants to save us all, even the rich. Jesus looks at us with love and wants to draw us into a new way of relating to God, to our wealth, and to our neighbors. We may be rich, selfish camels trying to force ourselves through the eye of a needle, desperate to attain something impossible on our own. But with God, all things are possible, even our salvation. Amen. Let us confess our faith together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the church and for the world. O God, the creator and preserver of all, we pray for all people, and especially those in any kind of need through famine, war, or natural disaster. Make your ways known upon earth, your saving power among all peoples. Help us to lighten their burden and to seek justice and peace for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that all who call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in holiness of life. Strengthen your church in the service of Christ, that we may be witnesses to your compassion. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, spirit, or relationship. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bless those who care for them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commit to your mercy all who have died. Grant us with them a share in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for ourselves and our ministries. Give grace to us, our families and friends, and to all our neighbors, that we may serve Christ and one another, and love as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Let us take a moment for silent prayer. Friends, Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and prayers.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You created for yourself a world filled with diversity and blessed by your breath of life. Rainbow colors bloom in spring, summer breezes bring garden delight, and now as autumn has come our way, we see the work of your paintbrush upon every face and tree. In mercy, while we still held to the chains of our winter of pride, self-righteousness, and historic egos, you loved us steadfastly and delivered us as babes to reflect the beauty and diversity of your grace and bring us into a community of love, hope, and peace. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. He prayed that we might be one as he is one with you, Father, and he asked that we might be known by the love we have for one another. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with your church throughout the whole world, and strengthen it in every nation and among every people to witness faithfully in your name. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Now, with the confidence of God's children, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We do not presume to come to your table, merciful God, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your great love and countless acts of mercy. We are not even worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the Lord who always delights in showing mercy. Feed us then, gracious Lord, with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, in this holy mystery, that we may live as new creatures, grow into his likeness, and forever live in him and he in us. These are God's holy gifts for God's holy people.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends, go forth in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen. Friends, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.